spiritual formation. And we are working. We're going to look at the Book of Ruth. This is really a neat book. So we're going to start with a prayer. Let us pray. Dear God, what a beautiful day you blessed us with. We are so grateful that we have the freedom to come together and look at your word. And as you reveal yourself, please guide me as I share what you shared, laid on my heart to share. Please be the Lord of this hour and guide us and direct us and open our eyes, ears, and hearts and minds to receive what you will have us to receive here. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
So we are in the Book of Ruth. So this is the overview, what this class, I'm going to try to go through some backgrounds about the Book of Ruth. And then we're going to look at what we call the Hesed, and we're going to go through all of the terminology from the Naomi's perspective, from Ruth's perspective, from Boaz's perspective. Those are the three main characters of the Book of Ruth. And then God's Hesed. Ultimately, it's about God. It's not about his people. And as you will see, these are very ordinary people, and having old, you know, just having life issues, things like widowhood, when things like losing loved ones, losing, you know, all your possessions and things like that. So, and I will have some Bible verses that I will ask some of you to be the readers. Obviously, we're going to be in the Book of Ruth. So if one of you will take Book of Ruth to be my reader, I would appreciate that. And I would need someone to be the Book of Job reader. And I can give some of the verses, so I can already have people assigned that way, you know, we can maximize the remaining 48 minutes. No, 52 minutes. So who will be my Ruth reader?
Let me speak.
Thank you. Who will be my Job reader?
Hello.
Oh, I'm sorry. Marie. Okay, Marie, would you do Job 27, 2 to 4? And then who will be my Deuteronomy reader?
I just have a question. Can you define that word Hesed?
We will.
Oh.
Hold your horses.
I'll do Deuteronomy.
Yeah. Deuteronomy, okay, 25, 5 to 10.
Okay.
And Galatians.
328.
Yes. And then Matthew 5:20. Thank you, Nancy. Okay. So this is the kind of overview of what we're going to spend next 15 minutes. What happened? Oh, it escaped my glass or something. There. Okay, so some background. Author is unknown. There's a speculation, just like Book of Judges. You know, the Samuel might be the author, but it's a speculation. But basically, author is unknown. Approximate date of the time that the Book of Ruth was written was, as it is indicated here. And the themes is Hesed. And God's redemptive plan through kinsman redeemer. That's also we're going to be defining it. And then it ends, the Book of Ruth ends with the lineage of David, who's ultimately the in the lineage of Jesus Christ, right? So far, so good.
Lucy, Thelma here. I'm online. You keep saying it's written here. I can't see what's on the PowerPoint presentation.
Yeah, for some reason, you're disconnected in your.
In other words, we're not seeing.
We're not seeing that.
Really?
Okay, then if you don't mind, if you please say the date or whatever.
Yeah, it is screen sharing.
Well, the problem is, Thelma, for some reason, the computer is not.
I understood. I just want her to tell me what's written on the board.
Right, I know. And for some reason,
I can't see anything.
We're trying to fix it.
No problem. Thank you.
Since I am sharing, okay, but for some reason, it's not.
That works.
Showing.
I can see all of you, which is nice. Hello.
Oh, all of a sudden, okay. So you were changing a different, okay, thing, and still we weren't seeing the changes.
Okay.
Well, there we go.
User error.
Okay,
please. Okay. Any questions so far about background?
No, it's good now.
Okay. Sorry about that.
Thank you. Thank you.
Welcome. So, I want to look at the background. You know, I'm going to tie back to a book of Joshua and Judges. Remember, this is the period, last week, Don did the Judges. So Israelites came out of Egypt in the book of Exodus, right? And then Joshua conquered he led them, the Israelites, to the promised land, and he was told to, wipe out all the Hittites, Jebusites, Moabites, right?
Yeah.
Israelites quite didn't do what God told them to do. And the book of Judges is time when they are being judged, right? And so they were going through the cycle of sinning. Oh, we are sorry. We are in pain. We are sorry. And God comes and rescues them. And they go like, oh, we are good. And then they go back to the cycle and that kind of stuff. And then the judges were sent to, picked to, get Israel. It's, come on, wake up kind of thing. So that's a brief review of where they are right now. Book of Ruth is, I will call it a very a shiny spotlight out of that dark times, because it's kind of a really neat story. But geographically, and I want to show you a map here, and I will try my best to okay, how do I get
to
escape?
Okay, there you go.
Now click
so I'm going to go here, share. And there, I need to get to the map. Oh dear, how do I move this thing? this whole thing.
You
know what?
No, great. Go out and then hit escape. Go out of that window there.
Yeah.
Escape.
Good. Get out of that.
Yeah. You might have to stop sharing.
There you go. Now hit escape.
Escape. Okay.
No. Okay. Stop sharing then.
Stop sharing. Sorry. This is just.
Is your map up on your computer already?
Yes.
Okay. So if you go to share again.
Right there. Okay.
But you got a screen share.
Now you have to go back to screen share. It's hard, huh?
Screen share.
Yeah, click on that. There we go.
There's too much to know.
Yeah. Well, that didn't work.
That didn't work.
There.
Is it showing up? No, it's
well, not it's showing not showing up. On us. You haven't screen shared yet.
How do I get to the screen share here? I think I'm gonna do this.
There you go. You have to find the Zoom interface.
The little.
Okay.
There.
Zoom, yeah.
This
Zoom
one
right there.
Yeah.
She's gotta get it, make it bigger because minimize.
Oh yeah, click on that. There. Now go to screen share. Ah.
Yeah, leave it there.
Share.
Hey, can I just ask a question? With the dates of 1010 to 970 BC, mm-hmm. dates of the events or the dates of the writing?
No, I can't get up. So
the events.
Okay.
Actually, according to this book,
Yeah, there just leave it that way. This so I can go out and then get here.
Different period of the books. On page here. So this is actually a transition period. Up till this time, up till, I guess, judges, they were in what they call the, up to the roots, actually, theocratic. So in other words, God is in, you know, in charge, right?
Theocracy, yeah.
Yeah. They started from patriarchic period, and then the theocratic, and now they're going to transition into monarchy. And then they kind of put Exodus and Ruth in the theocratic period between 1445 and 1043 BC.
Okay.
Anyway, so what I wanted to show you, because I'm a visual person, this website shows the map. So in Joshua 15, I believe, you know, the 12 tribes were given, the land was divided up to 12 tribes. And the reason I wanted to show you this is because where this is happening, and we're going to read Ruth 1, is that they are in Elimelech, and his family is actually, they started from Bethlehem. But then that famine happens, and they move to Moab, right? And so I thought it would be good to see visually where they are. And I think this map shows that pretty good. Let me see. Yeah, that map shows pretty good. And so either they will have to travel this way or that way. Don't know which way they traveled best, but bottom line is, Bethlehem is here and Moab is down here. And as we unpack the story, Ruth and Orpah are Moabites. They are from here, where Naomi and his, you know, her family is from Bethlehem. They are Jews. Okay? I hope that helped a little bit. And while we are here, because I'm having a hard time sharing back and forth, what I would like to do now is go to the next tab. I'm going to cheat.
There you go.
Let's look at the meaning of hesed. Here you go. Hesed. I think the simplest term definition I would use is royal love. So I'm real royal. Loyal, not royal. Loyalty and love. And love is not just, you know, the emotion thing, but active, carrying out active, and really being loyal to somebody, right? And you will see this story. And ultimately, the loyalty is what is one of the characteristics of our God. I mean, he's loyal, he's faithful, and he's loving, right? So loyal love, I will say, is the simplest definition. But it is a Hebrew word that talks about hesed. And while I'm at here, godquestions.org, I guess. Yeah, godquestions.org is a really good source. Well, when you are reading your Bible, if you run into something, if you have a question, this is a really good website. So there's a little plug-in for one of the resources that is very useful.
So I don't know if you guys in the back can see, but sometimes in the Bible it says mercy, compassion, love, grace, and faithfulness. They'll translate it from that word hesed.
Mm-hmm. Can you see that?
Mm-hmm.
It's in the back.
Seriously. I've heard love and that? Kindness too.
Okay. Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay. And then one other word that I'm going to go ahead and get it out of the way so I don't have to flip flop between the browser. The other one is a kinsman redeemer. And this is going to come in later in our discussion. It's basically you have to, if somebody in your family, in Israel, like, you know, the Jewish family, somebody dies, a guy, man, dies without a son, or if they are getting to the point where they have to sell their property, the land, then it has to stay within the family. So one of the family member, kinsman, has to purchase it or marry the widow, and so that, and then have son. And we're going to talk about that too. So that the property, the family can stay within the family. That's basically what kinsman means. Any additional comments or questions? Okay. So those are some of the terms. We're just going to go ahead and get it out of the way. I'm doing things out of my original plan, but that's okay. That's okay. So any questions, comments so far? Okay. Now, really, I want to get to the point where...
I think that kinsman is probably the closest relative to that person.
Right.
So they have the responsibility for their livelihood, basically.
Right. And that's in Book of Deuteronomy.
They can choose not to do it and pass it on.
Right.
Isn't that where the word next of kin comes from?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
It has to be. So, you know, one of the questions the Pharisees was trying to trap Jesus in New Testament. They said, oh, so what if there's a seven brothers? Remember that question? And that is the same thing. It's using this terminology, right? Okay. With that, I'm
Just real quick. So this is just in the kin, next of kin. This
has been coughing a lot. It's not good.
Just be the male. Right?
Yes.
So it wouldn't be a female. Maybe now, as we practice, we would use it. Next of kin would include a female.
Right? Yeah, usually at that time, female have no way of financially independent in the society.
Couldn't own land.
Yeah.
Didn't have property.
And so usually a male.
Yeah. So now I'm going to go to sharing. Of my PowerPoint. So how do I get back there? Let's see. How do I get back there?
So stop share.
Okay. Now let's share.
There's the share screen.
Share screen. This thing. Okay. Now I'm going to go back to full screen. Okay. What happened? There you go. So we did the geographical background and then went to the website. What happened? Did I not do again something right?
Go back. Stop share.
Why that's not working?
Okay, share screen. Click on the one on the far. Yeah, that one.
Oh, you know why? Because I do the movies after. Oh. Okay, so we just looked at the geographical and talked about Joshua 15 and they split up the land. And I mentioned about the period of judges. Now, cultural, we're going to talk a lot more about it. These two gentlemen briefly mentioned something about it. Now, I'm going to go into a little bit more detail than. What's been known before. So let's start with reading the Book of Ruth.
Okay.
First five verses of the chapter one.
Excellent. All right. In the days when the judges ruled, there was a famine in the land, and a man of Bethlehem in Judah went to sojourn in the country of Moab, he and his wife and his two sons. The name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife Naomi. And the names of his two sons were Mahlon and Chilion. They were Ephrathites from Bethlehem in Judah. They went into the country of Moab and remained there. But Elimelech, the husband of Naomi, died, and she was left with her two sons. These took Moabite wives. The name of the one was Orpah, and the name of the other Ruth. They lived there about 10 years, and both Mahlon and Chilion died,
so that the woman was left without her two sons and her husband.
Okay, so that is the setting the stage.
No offspring either.
Right. Just hold your horses. So Elimelech. Moved his family to Bethlehem because of the famine, right? That's in the first five verses it talks about. And then he dies, right? Now, most of us have lost loved ones. I mean, the grief does some tremendous things when you lose your loved ones, right? So just remember, Naomi is now grieving. She lost her husband. Oopsie. And then not only that, she loses her two sons. And so now that she has two widowed daughters-in-law, and they are all in foreign land. Well, she is in foreign land. So the daughters-in-law, they are not in foreign land because they are from Moab. Now, just catch the thing. So they are widow, and also they have no offspring. That is a big strike against these women already. Because women in that Bible time, and to a certain extent, Eastern culture, even nowadays, women do not have kind of rights that we Western civilizations enjoy. And I think that is really important to remember when we are reading the Bible. We tend to read through our Western eyes. But it is really important to remember, especially things like Book of Ruth and Esther. When Jesus talks about women, you know, Lydia and Hagar and Tamar, we tend to look at it as, okay, just being women. But it is the significance is that women did not have any rights. And so we have to really try to remember the cultural background, why these stories are so significant. So so Naomi is in just a total devastation. She lost her husband. She lost her two sons. I mean, as a parent, I mean, it would just be devastating to have your children die before you. So in their culture, women with no husband and no sons basically have no future because they don't have right to own anything. They don't. I'm just basically pointing out some of the situation, the situation that Naomi is in, as well as Ruth and Orpah is in. They only basically from first five verses of the book. And I think it's really important to get that, this kind of a background understood clearly, right? And we already talked about the, when you are grieving, and poor Naomi is grieving three times over, plus there's nothing left, right? No possessions, anything. I can't imagine her mental state, right? So all these things gonna play into the rest of the Book of Ruth. Any questions or comments so far? Okay. That's my little thing, because you are in destitute and you basically nothing there. So sometimes you have this get up and do stuff. Okay, some more cultural background. I'm gonna use, I'm from Korea, and I'm gonna use what I learned, and I think it is very similar to Bible times. So women, men and women in old time, Old Testament time and Eastern culture, I call it three Cains. Let me explain to you what that means. So this is I think it's from this book. I have this book and another book by Carolyn Custis James. And I have a reference.
Say the title. I don't know if they saw it on here.
The title is The Gospel of Ruth by Carol Custis James. Like I said, my last slide has my references. But this is the quote from her book. Without a father, husband, son, or other male relatives to speak and act in her defense, a woman had no voice, no legal rights, and no recourse against injustice. So basically, this woman is in a really bad place. So these three kings, so when I was growing up in Korea, I was told, and I think it is not just told, but it is believed, especially, you know, long time ago. Now things are changing a bit. I was told a woman needs parents when she's young. So that's the third king, you know, third leg. When she gets married, so when at the prime her age, she needs her husband. That's the third leg. And when she gets old, she needs her son or sons to take care of her. That's the third leg. That's what I mean by three kings. So even when I was growing up, there is this thing about, oh, women need men. And that's just the cultural background. I know that's hard to grasp for Western folks, right? But that was the cultural background.
In Chinese culture, the same thing. It says a woman should submit to her father, and then submit to her husband, and then submit to her sons.
Because in Chinese she needs culture, them, yeah.
In ancient Chinese culture.
Right.
Well, as my wife didn't learn that.
No. Set it down. Different times.
Yeah. In different place. Yeah. That's the thing.
Well, I have to tell you, I don't know where I'd be without my wife.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's you talk about a woman needing a man. It works the other way too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because ancient Chinese culture, they didn't have that understanding of the helper. As God created Eve, helper, and in the Bible, the helper is the military aid.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
For David, yeah, that's
Azer.
Azer, yeah, that's not the kitchen help. Yeah. It's Azer, military help.
Also, spiritual helper.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, exactly.
So, a little bit more about the culture.
Oh yes, definitely.
A little bit more about the cultural background. So, womanhood and marriage. So, woman has to get married because her parents will not live forever, right? And then, so remember, Naomi became a single parent for a little while, right? So single parenthood and marriage arrangements. So if you don't have a husband and you have to arrange your children's marriage, because the children, they don't date and get married like the way they are, right? All of these things are arranged, even when, ever since they are little and things like that. That's all done by mail. So when you are left alone with two sons, who has to arrange the marriage? And then, of course, barrenness in Old Testament time, I mean, that's considered a curse, right?
Mm-hmm.
They're punished. If a woman does not have a baby, does not produce a son, not just a children, but son, then something's wrong with her, right? And so we see that with Sarah. We see that with Hannah. Right?
Mm-hmm.
No, Rachel, I'm sorry. So so all these things play into the play. Now, I'm bringing a little bit of the next year things. So women have to be submissive, passive, whatnot. They are helpless, but sometimes they have to take risks. I think I beat this one to death. So any questions or comments so far?
And there's some women that were pretty powerful I don't be with her lifestyle, but Deborah was a pretty powerful woman as one of the judges.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then the one in Proverbs where she would go out and buy a field. And they were actually, women were in some parts of the world actively involved.
Has to be.
Yeah.
It's not all male.
When you were talking about submission to father and then husband, does it include submission to all men? Like, for instance, what you said, is the woman expected to be submitted to all men or just men?
The saying is that woman of virtue, you submit to your father, your husband, and your sons.
Okay. But not all men, just...
No.
But the society expects you to respect all men. Okay. Basically.
All right. I was just curious about that.
That the culture.
Okay.
Right. So remember, I mentioned that she has to, a woman has to get married and then bear her sons, not just kids. Okay.
In the Philippine culture, if you want to hear about it, it's patriarchal. When the husband dies, it becomes matriarchal.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah. Huh.
Like
you said, it becomes matriarchal if the husband dies.
Mm-hmm. In the Philippine culture.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Alma.
So here's some contrast that I'd like to point out. Remember the Boaz, Naomi, and Ruth are the main three characters. Mm-hmm. So I'm continuing with this the cultural theme as well as in this the rest of the Ruth. So if we contrast to Boaz and Naomi and Ruth, here are some of the things. Men versus women, right? Mm-hmm. Obvious.
Yeah.
Boaz is powerful. Remember, he's a rich guy. And, and back then, if you are rich, it's not just a possession, but that means you are respected and you have authority and all that things. And Naomi and Ruth they are very powerless and they are very vulnerable. And wealthy versus poverty. And Boaz has all the advantage. He's the Jewish male with the power and authority and wealth. And Naomi and Ruth, they are vulnerable and they're in a bad place. And independent versus destitute. So am I making enough contrast here to show, the total different background between them. So the reason I mentioned Job is because there has been some commentators thinking that Naomi, remember she's one of, I think, when she goes back to Bethlehem, and the Jews are like, oh, Naomi's back and everything else, and but she says, no, call me Mara, meaning bitter. And so there are some commentators think that Naomi turned bitter. Well, I found I have a quote here. That's one angle to look at, but that is not really the truthful angle. Again, remember, women are looked as less than men, and I think there are still some of that tendency when we look at the Bible, where women are looked at a little bit lower. But anyway, they were both devout Jews, and they were both went through quite a trial, right? Job lost everything and all that. But their love for Yahweh, their God, did not waver. Just because Naomi said, God has dealt with me harshly, so call me Mara, bitter, that doesn't mean that she turned bitter. And here is the quote by a guy, not a woman, John MacArthur, says, she acknowledged that it is the Lord who gives and takes away, and lamented the bitter cup as Job did, not necessarily became a bitter person as some may suggest. So who has Ruth 121, Tracy.
Okay, 121. Mm-hmm. I went away full, and the Lord has brought me back empty. Mm-hmm. Why call me Naomi when the Lord has testified against me, and the Almighty has brought calamity upon me?
Okay. Now, who is Job? Yeah, thank you.
And God is, who has taken away my justice? And the Almighty, who has made my soul bitter? As long as my breath is in me, and the breath of God in my nostrils, my lips will not speak wickedness, nor my tongue utter deceit.
Thank you. Any questions, comments about that one? Okay, we already looked at Hesed. So this one I can just breeze through, right?
What was it? Job what?
Job 27, 2 to 4.
Thank you.
Hesed is driven not by duty or legal obligation, but by a bone-deep commitment, a loyal, selfless love that motivates a person to do voluntarily what no one has a right to expect or ask of them. And Hesed is really the gospel. Emotion.
Hmm. I like that, voluntarily, but no one has a right or expect to ask.
Mm-hmm. And who's the ultimate giver? Who demonstrated the ultimate hesed?
Jesus.
So, Book of Ruth may not say God, you know, mm-hmm. God commanded whatever, but he is behind all of this. And in these ordinary people, he's beyond orchestrating all of these things. Now, let's look at the Naomi's hesed. Now that we don't know what hesed means. So Naomi is in a bad place. I think I'm brought that, beat that horse to death. Okay. Basically, Orpah and Ruth had absolutely no future in Bethlehem. And so Naomi's now, remember the Orpah, after they said, no, we're gonna stay with you. Because Naomi said, I'm going to go back to Bethlehem, but you girls will stay behind. This is your land, and you go find your husband, new husband. Because that way, they will be taken care of. But remember, they both said, no, we're going to stay with you. But then Ruth makes a very compelling argument. And so Orpah decides to, take her mother-in-law's advice and go back to their family, Moabite family. But Ruth says, no, I'm going to stay. Your people will be my people. Your God will be my God. And I'm going to stay until the day we part by death. Sounds like marriage vow. But anyway.
That's what Moses said to me.
Oh, yeah. But that bottom line is, this Moabite women, now they become the foreigner in Bethlehem. Remember the map?
Mm-hmm.
And so Ruth will have no future. And so now Naomi is going to say, now she's going to try to take the steps to make sure that the Ruth gets taken care of. So Naomi's hurting and she has no future, but she's looking after Ruth.
Well, also, if Ruth was to find somebody and have a child, that would be her redeemer too for Naomi.
I'm getting ahead of
you. You're too smart.
Yeah.
You are not too smart.
So the last bullet in this, Naomi's hesed towards Orpah and Ruth. Her choices are radical and costly. It's costly for her because she's beyond the childbearing age, right? Naomi is. So she doesn't have any future, but she acts in complete freedom. She's looking for Orpah and Ruth. And so her choices are radical and costly for her, but she acts in complete freedom for their benefit, which is the hesed, right? So remember that. Now, how about Ruth? Hesed towards. Now, by the way, when we talk about all of this is in chapter 2, and then Ruth hesed toward into this chapter 2, also in parts of chapter 3. Now, Ruth could go back just like Orpah, but well, she doesn't. So she basically saying, no, I'm going to stay with you. And I'm going, when I stay with you, I don't mean just stay with you, but she's going to be supporting. Here's the word Azer we talked about. Now, when I read this part, where let me see. This is in, where is it? Where she goes to Glean. Yeah, chapter 2, Tracy.
Mm-hmm.
Starting verse 2.
Okay.
And 3.
Verses 2 and 3 of chapter 2.
Yes, please.
And Ruth the Moabite said to Naomi, let me go to the field and glean among the ears of grain after him in whose sight I shall find favor. And she said to her, go, my daughter. So she set out and went and gleaned in the field after the reapers. And she happened to come to the part of the field belonging to Boaz, who was of the clan Elimelech.
Happened to be. Happened to be, right. It just happened.
Exactly.
But when I read that particular portion, you know what came into my mind? Remember when in Genesis, when the famine hit and Joseph was already, second man in charge in Egypt, because he'd interpreted a dream and he had the 7 years of planning and setting all that.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's a later part of, I guess, around chapter, or somewhere around there, where Jacob tells his sons, said, don't look at each other, go to Egypt and get some grain or something, for crying out loud.
Yeah.
It is such a contrast. Here is Ruth. I mean, she's taking a big risk and said, let me go glean. Now, gleaners are, again, there's the shearers who cut the wheat with a
sickle,
thank you. And then there's the people who come behind and bundling, right? And then comes the gleaners. So, but she's saying, okay, me being a foreign woman, let me go and glean. So she's taking a big chance, but she's going to take some risk and do something about it instead of just sitting there, you know, wondering, how are we going to eat? I think that's pretty cool. Sometimes we have to just take some risks. And her risk-taking was to make sure that she can support Naomi as well as herself.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I think that just made that point. It's a hard work, but it's dangerous, especially for young widow. Foreign woman.
She's young, unattached woman.
It's a dangerous point. So, I don't know why I said let's re-examine 2:7 and 3:9. Tracy?
Yes, okay. So, 2:7,
mm-hmm.
Chapter 2, verse 7. She said, please let me glean and gather among the sheaves after the reapers.
Mm-hmm.
So she came and she has continued from early morning until now, except for a short rest.
Mm-hmm.
And then 3:9?
Yes.
3:9 says, he said, I'm assuming Boaz, yeah,
mm-hmm.
said, who are you? And she answered, I am Ruth, your servant. Spread your wings over your servant, for you are a redeemer.
Okay, that's just risk takers. So that's I'm jumping ahead. But
Ruth said that?
Ruth said that to Boaz.
Yeah. This is in the after the glean happened and that night. So I'm kind of jumping ahead.
Yeah,
but bottom line is she's a risk taker, she's an active. So remember Hesed is not just loyalty, but it's a loyal love that's taking actions to help. That's what I guess. She commits herself to Naomi and Naomi's God. We already talked about that. Now, this last bullet, remember the last bullet of the Naomi's Hesed towards Ruth and Orpah? Ruth Hesed towards Naomi is also, this is radical and costly, But she acts in complete freedom. Nobody's forced her. She took up on her first, you know, initiative, right? Okay. I'm running out of time here. So now let's look at that. She happens to be at the Boaz's field, right? Mm-hmm. Now, the Boaz is a true foreshadowing of Christ, his character, right? Because he's the kinsman redeemer, but he is very generous, and he does more than just what's required. He is a true picture of doing the spirit of the law, not just the letter of the law. Mm-hmm. The letter says, letter of the law says, let them believe. This is in, I don't know where, somewhere, Leviticus, I think. Probably. But the spirit of the law says, feed them. Says you go beyond them. And in chapter 3, I believe, you know, he asks, well, who are you? And the Ruth tells, you know, no, actually, he asked one of his guys, who is that woman? And he tells Boaz about who Ruth is and what she's done and everything else. And he goes way above and beyond, and he feeds her at their table, you know, allows her to eat. And by the way, that's the first doggy bag.
He didn't. He let her
take out her order.
Yeah. And that's one of the first lies, too. You know,
huh?
That I'm taking this for my dog.
You know? Yeah.
Yeah.
But
he tells her to where to go. You know, and tells his gleaner, tell them to just leave some extra for Ruth to, you know, glean. And so she gleans a lot, right? Anyway, so he's being generous, not only to his workers, but to Ruth. And it's also promising protection for her. And continue. So it is gospel in action. We talked about kinsmen already, kinsmen redeemer. Who was the Deuteronomy 25, 5 to 10? Okay.
5 to 10?
Mm-hmm.
If brothers live together and one of them dies without having a son, the dead man's wife must not remarry someone outside the family. Instead, her late husband's brother must go to her, marry her, and perform the duty of brother-in-law. Excuse me. Then the first son she bears will continue the name of the dead brother, thus preventing his name from being blotted out of Israel. But if the man does not want to marry his brother's widow, then she must go to the elders at the town gate and say, my husband's brother refuses to preserve his brother's name in Israel. He is unwilling to perform the duties of the brother-in-law to me. Then the elders of the city must summon him and speak to him. If he persists, saying, I don't want to marry her, then his sister-in-law must approach him in view of the elders, remove his sandals from his foot, and spit in his face. Sorry. She will then respond, thus may it be done to any man who does not maintain his brother's family line. His family name will not be referred to in Israel as the family of the one whose sandal was removed.
There you go. No. Mm-hmm. So the kinsman redeemer, one of the things, if the brother or somebody else comes and marries and produces an heir, he has to split his own inheritance. Because the firstborns usually get double, right? And so it's costly. Mm. So again, here, just like the other two Hesed, you know, Naomi's Hesed and Ruth Hesed, Boaz's Hesed is also radical and costly, but he acts in complete freedom. There's a common theme running here.
I can't remember it's in the Old Testament or New Testament, and it says, If you own a field and your workers are working and they harvest it one time, do not make them to go right, back and harvest the second time. Right. Leave those for the foreigners and the women. Widows. and widows.
That's Leviticus 19.
Leviticus. Yeah.
So, you know, Ruth happens to be at the Boaz's field, and then there's a lot of happens to him, you know, in this book.
In the Bible.
Right, but.
Yes, there is.
But so, bottom line is, God is at work in all of our circumstances, and He meets us in all of our circumstances, including suffering. And then He's hesed toward us, and I don't think that we need to expand. I mean, we know what He's done, right? So He is our ultimate true kinsman redeemer.
Yes, we know we have one.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Because we lost everything because of our sin, but He's the one who did. And His choices are radical and costly. He costed Him everything, including separation from, you know, His Father. But He acted in complete love.
Mm-hmm.
Complete love.
That's amazing.
It is amazing. It is amazing. Let that sink in a little bit. So, I'd like to end with the applications. What can we learn from these passages? Naomi went through a pretty bad time. But our struggles are, I mean, we have struggles. They are real. And God meets us there. But we are equipped to be a strong Azer, risk takers, a strong helper, and all that, because He meets us. And He is behind all of our circumstances. Galatians 3:28. Who has that?
Thank you. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slaves, nor free, nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
It's our New Testament for all.
So even the culture says women, widow, barren women, all of that, you know, that's why I did a contrast between the Job and Naomi, the Boaz and the Ruth and Naomi. We have all these things that we put together, you know, comparing one, putting in different categories. But ultimately, our value, our worth is not from whether we are rich, poor, male, female, Jew or Gentile, widow or single or married, have kids, barren, whatnot. Our value comes only from God.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that is the ultimate.
Mm-hmm.
And in God's eyes, we are all His children that He willingly, you know, hesed toward us in spite of His all the radical and costly, but out of complete love.
And I think what is cool is that, I mean, in human history, women have no value, considered as property of man in the ancient cultures. But from the Bible, from the very beginning, when God created Eve, He created her equal to Adam.
Mm-hmm.
From the very beginning till now, it's all the same. Even through the judges, God used some woman as judge in Israel history. And all throughout the history, women are equal to men.
Yes.
Yes. That's really cool.
I was thinking too, as we were talking about it, that it's that Galatians 3:28 passage just radicalized the world, if you think about it.
Yeah.
This is why Eastern cultures, Middle Eastern, Eastern Asian cultures still have the patriarchal tier where women are subjugated.
Mm-hmm.
And there's issues in the Western white world too, but Christianity changed that thing. That's why the Western world doesn't understand things like that. It was Christianity that changed, evened out male and female, that eventually rid us of slavery in the end. It was all that kind of stuff. It was an absolute radical world-changing view. Thousands of years of culture were changed by Jesus doing that, and then Galatians saying that. Now we're even. Yeah. Jesus evened everything out.
Yeah.
It's really just incredible world change. It is.
Yeah, because when Paul wrote this, Jew, they considered Gentile as dogs.
Yeah.
And male and female, they're not right. Equal.
I'm glad I'm not born with a woman.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, really.
You can think, you know, the number of women that have been looked down upon for being barren.
Yeah.
That were married to infertile men,
mm-hmm.
and you know,
right.
and women that were looked down upon because they didn't produce sons.
Right.
When it's the male that decides
exactly.
The gender,
yes.
I mean, it's
exactly. Like, it's all women's fault,
right?
Yeah,
it's Eve's fault, right?
Yeah, it's Eve's fault, right? I think. There is hope because when we look at the, it is easy to look at the Israelites and be like, oh man, did they get it wrong? And we get it wrong a lot of the time, but it's good to see that there is a person who went not just looking at the law and was very stuck to it. Like Boaz also took that risk.
Yeah.
Because he is looking at like, basically if he is within the culture, is this woman is trash, basically. I shouldn't even be talking to her.
Yeah.
Yeah. But he went, what I'm hearing is he went and learned about her.
Mm-hmm.
He got personal with her.
So not only that, when he came, you know, he came from somewhere and came back, and he would say to his workers, bless you, and they will all turn around. So he was a kind of owner, leader, whatever. But he was kind to everybody. I mean, he that was his character,
mm-hmm.
right? And so, yeah, I mean... He's the foreshadowing of Jesus Christ all throughout, right? But we see that chesed coming through Naomi and Ruth as well, right? So, and I added this last bullet because, you know, Boaz and Ruth really had good, from what the rest of the story, what we read, they were very... happily live after, right? Because their relationships built on kindness, respect, commitment, and all of that. Hesed again. I'm trying to brush through.
Boaz's name appeared in Matthew chapter 1, verse 5. Salmon, the father of Boaz.
So if you Matthew 1, not only Boaz is showing up, but it shows the women, right?
Mm-hmm.
Other women. So how can this passage impact my life, our life? Okay, one Cain, not three Cain. I think that we're going to read this Galatians passage. We may have to make some radical choices and take actions and take some risks. Most of us, especially this one, I don't want to take risks.
Yeah, even when God says, I will give you the land flowing with milk and honey, when they got there, they have to go fight.
There you go.
And a lot of people died, radical and costly.
Yeah.
And God has given them the land, but they have to go fight.
Yeah. And then the reason I put this one is because from that marriage, Perez, Obed, and who became the father of Jesse and the father of David, ultimately the lineage of Christ. So it's not just a lineage, but the legacy. The legacy that was left by Naomi, by Ruth, by Boaz, and so forth. So there are a lot more stuff that I could have talked about, but I just wanted to really emphasize the background. Because it's easy for us to look at the story through Western eyes.
Yeah.
So, and like I said, this is some of my references. And so that's all I have.
Good job.
Thank you, Susie. It was an overview, not in depth. Could someone pray for us so we can go to service now? Who would pray?
Okay.
Thank you.
Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the rain. We thank you that we have the freedom to come and to worship you and to be here with one another. That is truly amazing. And so we praise you for that. Father, we thank you for this this study on Ruth and being able to see how you work and to see the amazing things that you do in people's lives.
Okay.
Pray, Father, as we leave here and go continue to worship in the service, that you would continually remind us of that you are working constantly and that you call us to join you where it is that you're working. Keep our eyes open, keep our ears open, keep our hearts and minds open to what it is that you're doing, Father. And we lift the rest of this day up to you. We pray, Father, that above all else, that you would be glorified in all that we do and all that we say. And we pray all these things in Jesus' holy and precious name. Amen.
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 Susie, thank you so much.
Yes.
Thank you.
Susie, can you send me the PowerPoint slides?
Hey, Sally, this is just almost the same PowerPoint I had on the Ruth before. So
okay. Okay. I wasn't sure if it was the same one or not.